Another really popular application of second-order ODEs is to look at the Rlc circuit. And in case you haven't had a Physics 2 class or haven't had a circuits class, then whenever you look at these examples, though, they seem really, really obnoxious and obscure, and at least the spring thing kind of makes sense. So something that's important here, and I kind of like it, is this kind of little table of analogies from circuits to mechanics. So if you think about something like voltage, voltage is like a force on a circuit, like kind of making the charges move. So you can think about voltage as being an external force. The current is basically how fast are those charges moving, so it's velocity. The charge itself would be like the displacement. Resistance in a circuit basically keeps charges from moving. So you can think about that as damping, like with the spring. These two are a little bit more confusing if you don't know what they are, but inductance and capacitance can act kind of like mass and a bit of the spring constant. Now, voltage itself, we call in certain people, some people call it V, some people call it E. If you call it E, it's because probably, I think, it was originally called the electromotive force. So, or EMF, if you've seen electromotive force or potential difference. But anyway, voltage, for the purposes of this, we'll call it E, and it's measured in volts. We have current, which is measured in amperes, or amps, and we call that capital A. Charge, you may or may not know, is measured in coulombs. And again, I'm just kind of giving you just a basic getting started of this, just in case, and there's another stupid C, but charge is measured in coulombs. Resistance is measured in ohms, which is this upside down omega, not upside down, but this omega sign. Inductance, I'm going to tell you what inductance is in a second, but inductance is something that's measured in Henry's, something called Henry's. And capacitance is measured in something called farads. Okay, now, inductance, what an inductor is an inductor is like this little spirally thing. So if you've ever made like an electromagnet where you spun the wire around, and basically you have this magnetic force that kind of like alleviates, comes out from those spirally things, that's an inductor. And what we know about the inductor is that the voltage across the inductor is controlled by basically the speed of the current going through it. So that's just something to know, that the voltage across an inductor is proportional to the speed at which the current runs through it. So the voltage is L di dt. Now a capacitor, so that's an inductor. That's an inductor. Now a capacitor is like basically these two plates that are parallel. This is like a super, super tight view, but basically what happens is you end up with all these charges kept on one side and the charges kept on the other side, and that also creates a voltage. Now, we describe this slightly differently, but we'll say that this is slightly backwards, but, well, just backwards if you're comparing it to the inductor. But for capacitor, we say that the current that can flow across a capacitor, so if I want to know how much current goes across a capacitor, that is equal to the capacitance times the derivative of the voltage. So basically, the change in voltage across that capacitor times the capacitance, the rate of change of the voltage across the capacitor, times its capacitance is going to tell you how much current is allowed to go through that. So all that said, probably may or may not help if you've never seen any of this before, but at least trying to give you some level of context so that whenever we do this in a second, you can play along. So let's say that we have this circuit, and it's got a resistor, and it's got an inductor, and it's got a capacitor. Like this. And there's this thing called mesh analysis, which is based on Kirchhoff's voltage law. And Kirchhoff's voltage law says that that as I go through a circuit, in any loop, the sum of the voltages has to equal zero. So if I have a resistor with resistance R, an inductor with inductance L, and a capacitor with capacitance C, basically what I can do is I can relate the current to each one of those things. So the current, or the voltage drop across the resistor, is equal to I times R, and that's something else I didn't really mention, but the voltage drop across a resistor, I was hoping that you already knew that, is IR. The voltage drop across a inductor is L dI/dt. So that's the voltage drop across an inductor. And then the voltage drop across a capacitor, now in order to do that, I've actually got to solve for voltage. So to solve for voltage, I've got I over C dE dt. So the voltage drop across a capacitor is actually 1 over C integral I dt. Now, so capacitance is considered constant, but the current would not be constant because it's going through this inductor that's kind of messing it up into the capacitor. So the current's not constant, so I can't pull it out. And if it was constant, then that term would be 0 anyway, so that's, again, not really helpful. Times this, I dt is equal to 0. L dI dt. Beautiful. Okay, so that is this guy. Now, I don't like having that integral in there, so I can actually use something. I can do a little bit of a transformation. Now, the current through something is also defined. See, I'm just assuming you know all this, and I'm sorry. That's just what it's like in a math class. The current is defined as the rate of change of charge. So faster the charge goes, the faster the current is. So kind of intuitive if you already know what it is. If you don't already know what it is, probably not intuitive at all. But essentially what we can do is we can use this to change some things around. So that means that Q is equal to the integral of I dt, and it also means that dI dt is equal to d squared Q dt squared, or Q prime, Q double prime, sorry. So I can actually do a quick little plug-in here. So instead of IR, I can say I, or not I, instead of I can say Q prime R. And then for L dI dt, DL dI dt is actually Q double prime. And then I can replace that integral I dt with just Q, and that equals 0. So the whole point is that now I have a lovely L Q double prime plus R Q prime plus 1 over C Q equals 0. And now this is for specifically an RLC circuit, and we call that in series. So that means you have to go through one to get to the other. So you'll remember in my picture, I had all of these kind of went in a row. So when I went in here, I had to come out. So there's really only one way to go. That's called a series circuit. So this equation really only applies for RLC circuits that are in series. If you have RLC circuits in parallel, that's a totally other kind of thing. The good news is that once you have this equation, you can actually use it without knowing what it means anymore, which is always the goal of any good mathematician student. That's not true, but it kind of feels true. So anyway, now we can actually solve some problems that are kind of related to this. So let's actually just do one of these problems. So basically the idea is you have a certain time, you have a current, RLC circuit with a certain R, L, and C. And you're also given another initial condition as well. So you actually have two initial conditions. So see what you can figure out on your own. Pause the video, see if you can plug things in, see if you can figure out what your initial values are for your IVP, and then come back to this video and see how far along you got. So let's figure out what our actual initial value problem is. So we've got something pretty straightforward, that Q at 0 is equal to 1 coulomb. And the other thing, though, that we're given is that the initial current is 2 amps. Now, since the initial current is 2 amps, you remember that current is equal to the change of rate in charge. So that's dQ dt is equal to 2 amps. So there we go. Beautiful. So our equation is L Q double prime plus R Q prime plus 1 over C Q equals 0. We have that the resistance R is 40, that the inductance L is 0.2, and the capacitance C is 10 to the negative 5. And now we just plug those in. 0.2 Q double prime plus 40 Q prime plus 1 over that, which is just this to the positive is equal to 0. Beautiful. I don't like those things, so I'm just going to make this 2 Q to 2 plus 400 Q to 2 plus 10 to the 6th Q. I could go ahead and do this. 1 with 10 sixes, or no, 1 with 6 tens. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, Q. And then Q double prime plus 200 Q prime plus 5 with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 zeros. There we go. That's lovely. Now I can write a characteristic equation and just solve it. Beautiful. Negative B. And I'll just work this out. And there I go. Which means that I have a solution in the form Q equals E to the negative 110. Negative 100 T. A cosine 700 T plus B sine 700 T. In order to apply my initial conditions, that means I need to take a first derivative, which I will also do. And I have that here. Now, I've got that Q naught initial condition is equal to 1, which means A is equal to 1. That's always nice. And then I have that my first derivative is equal to, I think we said 2. 2? Yes, 2. So that's negative 100 A plus 700 B. And then I can plug stuff in. Like that. So that means that I can get a full solution of e to the negative 100 t cosine 700 t plus 51 over 350 sine 700 t. And that's basically describing the charges as it's flowing through. Is that if you have that kind of initial condition, then in a pretty quick amount of time that the charges through the system is going to go shoo-doo-doo-doo-doo, and then the movement is going to just kind of chill out almost immediately. So that's kind of helpful. It's kind of cool. You can go through here and you can solve these RLC circuits using this exact same methodology. And even if you have a non-zero on the other side, if you have a, whatever you call those things, non-homogeneous equations, then you can still just solve it the exact same way that you've been doing it before, but you can like put on your little fancy hat and be like, yay, I'm doing applications.